hard time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good.
I have been coming to Barbados for over 50 years, and of all the people I met, Doc stands out in the crowd. He was an absolute gentleman and a good friend to us. And last year, when I was recovering from back surgery, he helped me walk again in the sea and spent a long time with me. We will both miss you, Doc. Although we feel privileged to have met you.
Doc used to train me on the beach at Crystal Cove. I used to wake up at 6:30 in the morning, and there he'd be with the tires and the kayak. My fondest memory of Doc was when we hiked up near Bridgetown. We got the kayak and we kayaked all the way back to Crystal Cove. I was so tired that day that I sat in the back of the kayak and I'd stopped rowing. Doc was laughing so hard at me, and he decided that he was going to just row back. I'd missed breakfast because we'd been out so long. He just got some mangoes and we ate fresh mangoes. We both had the passion of training and dogs. We used to talk a lot when we were back in England. He was very supportive and he'll be very missed. Some comfort here.
Hello everyone. First of all, I'd like to extend my condolences to Nigel's friends, loved ones, and family. I first got acquainted with Nigel because my name is Nigel as well, and we would have some gatherings together. And what I remember most about him is that he loved discussions, and he was one who was very articulate and strong in any point or point of view he had on any issue or topic. And I truly enjoy our interactions together, and I will really miss
it. Yeah. Hello everyone, my name is Keja. I've known Nigel for a few years, and he taught me in both my common entrance examinations and my CSAT examinations. On some mornings of summer, Nigel would catch the bus and come down to my house at 5 a.m. so we could go kayaking. Yeah, he went out of his way to do that, and I'm very thankful. I also want to extend my condolences to his family, and I hope they're good.
Hello, everyone. My name is Angela. I've known Nigel since I was a teenager, and he was always very nice, not only to me, but to my family. He would come to our home on different activities we would have here. And he was always there for my children. This is KJ, my son. KJ could have called him anytime, and he was always there to help KJ with whatever difficulty he was having. He would be greatly missed by my families, friends of ours, but he was a great guy. And we will miss him very, very, very much. Our condolences to his family, close relations, and
he was a very nice person. I am Judy Austin. My memories of Doc. Doc was more than my friend. He was a brother to me and an uncle to my grandsons. He has lifted my spirit and made me see the positive many a time in situations where I was completely overwhelmed. He has made me laugh when I thought I had nothing to laugh about. He helped me to create a beautiful food garden, which I started with little to no knowledge of what I was doing. He selflessly dedicated his time to teach me about the making of garden beds and planting and caring for such. I am extremely thankful and grateful for his time and knowledge. When my 7-year-old grandson was struggling with his mathematics, Doc came to my house religiously to help him finding the most fun ways to teach him, and the improvement was soon seen by all. He took my teenage grandson under his wing and taught him to kayak, how to ride his bike on the streets, took him on hikes, and many more things that I know will stay with him for life, like tying his school tie to enter fifth form. The most impressionable thing he did for my grandson was to help him prepare for his CXC maths exams, which he passed at grade 2 at 14 years old in fourth form. Lots of dedicated time and patience on Doc's part. Doc was always concerned about seeing the reports of children around him, not only those he tutored. He was passionate about making sure they had the tools they needed to face this world. I remember once I showed him my grandson's report, and all the grades were good, but in chemistry, he got a 27%. Doc looked at us and said, "Mr. Sadiq," that's what he called my grandson. He always addressed the children with the respect he expected them to show him. "This 27," he said, "is an 87. I will work with you. No money was involved here, just love and caring." So said, so done. The next term report, Sadiq had an 87% in chemistry and still doing well. This is the Doc, Mr. Beckles, I remember and love. He was an asset to all who knew him truly. There is so much more I can say about this wonderful man, brother, uncle, father, friend, loving, straightforward, no nonsense, Mr. Doc. He taught me to kayak at 59 years old, something I thought I would never do and would not have without him. Many of us, if we are honest with ourselves, have fought the battle with life. We survived because of people like Doc. I love you, brother, and you will live in my ever so grateful memories of you. To Jah be the glory. Peace.
And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. When I see you again.
Damn. Knew. All the planes we flew, good things we've been through, that I'll be standing right here talking to you about another path. I know we love to hit the road and laugh, but something told me that it wouldn't last. Had to switch up, look at things different, see the bigger picture.
I've been Nigel's nephew. If you know the gentleman in terms of the life we are here to celebrate, us starting promptly at 10 o'clock would have been very important to him. The discipline in which he lived his life will not allow us to be late. That being said, we had to move a few vehicles based on the how we are parked. There's one more vehicle, SA-1351. All right, and as soon as KB is back from moving his, we can start. Thanks for being here.
Good morning, everyone. We are here for a service of thanksgiving for the life of Nigel Martin Doc Beckles. How you see him on the front here, sir, is the same way we always knew him. I've never seen him dress any other way except at Laetitia Beckles' funeral just a few weeks ago, when I saw him in the suit for the first time. I've known him since 1982, so that's 42 years without seeing him in a suit. And I might realize the day I wore my high tops because Nigel never wore sneakers that were low cuts. He always wore high tops. When I first met him, he taught me some tips in basketball. And I said, "Are you a basketball coach?" He said, "No." Then I started playing lawn tennis. He taught me some lawn tennis too. I said, "Are you a lawn tennis coach?" He said, "No." Then I started keeping dogs. He taught me so much about dogs. I said, "Wait, you're a dog breeder or dog trainer?" He said, "No." Later on, I learned he was a teacher, which is all of those things. And Nigel was responsible for teaching more or less the foundation of our nation. You might realize a little guy from Queens College here taught you, right? You end up in Queens College. And that's the sort of teacher Nigel was. You ended up in a place that probably sometimes you never thought you would end up. And there are countless families, just like this young man's family, that can say Nigel is the reason their child is where their child is. I saw Nigel at Letitia's wedding. Fennel was here and she was part of the whole thing. I'm controlling this sound, just lower it a little bit, man, because you would do it? Okay, cool. And he was in a suit and everything. And then the next week, I heard he had passed away. And there's There's a song by Lionel Richie. Now this moment reminds me of, and I won't sing it. No, I won't, you know, put you all through that. But I will tell you the last verse of the song. You can look it up on YouTube or Google it. It's called Goodbye by Lionel Richie. And the last verse says, there's peace in where you are. Maybe all I need to know, if I listen to your heart, I'll hear your laughter once more. So now I gotta say, I'm just glad you came my way. It's never easy to say goodbye. This man was a man and a half and a piece on top. And if anyone here like me knew Nigel from sports, from dogs, from academics, he was my intellectual ping pong partner. We could talk intellect back and forth and change words according to how we wanted to. My heart goes out to the family and friends, especially my niece Katrina, who I've known from a baby. Please, let's have a moment of silence for Nigel Doc Beckles. Thank you. I'm not good at prayers or anything, so I'm a spiritual man, but not really religious, if you understand the definition. But at the same time, my prayers go out to the family, friends, everyone who this man's life touched. He certainly, definitely had a major impact on mine. On behalf of myself, my family, my friend Sophia Sinclair, I was definitely blown away by Nigel. She's a fellow teacher, and they used to talk syllabus, markings, all sorts of percentages together. Phenomenal guy. Let's begin by singing the congressional song, Waymaker.
In the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, turning light around. I worship you. You are here, you're healing every heart. I worship you. I
Waymaker, miracle worker, come and speak the light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Yeah, you are.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Thank you. I like that song real bad. That's the first time I hear it. Yeah, that's the first time I ever heard that song, but you know, I know melodies and I know music and I know when it's laid down right. And that song is definitely laid down right. Just give me one moment. I want to sign this thing. The people who will come to speak now probably have known Nigel all their lives. Probably just like me, they never see him much more close than this. Like I told you, in the 42 years I knew the man, I've only seen him fully clothed once. So we're gonna call on those people giving tributes, starting with, of course, his beautiful daughter. And I believe you know who's gonna give those tributes also, Katrina Thomas.
Morning, everyone. Again, thank you guys for being here in this time. As everyone is gonna come and say, if you knew Nigel, if you knew Doc. So naturally, if you knew my father, then you would know that he was fiercely loyal, extremely independent, very no-nonsense, blunter than only Jesus knows, and when ready, sharper than any sword. Today, I just wanted to share a few moments that I would have shared with him, and more so from my childhood, because those are even more fond to me than some of my adult years. I remember when I was growing up, he used to live right next door. Easy access, any time of the day. And I couldn't wait until school ended to run on home just to see what he was cooking. Always in the kitchen, always making something new, always fusing something together. And one of my very first cooking lessons was rotis. I can't remember how to make rotis worth my salt, but I remember those lessons. My hands were, at the time, even too small to hold all the dough together, but it was just a joy to stand next to him and endure the process. As Kevin said, he was a teacher at heart, and therefore he took joy in teaching every single thing. Self-taught in just about every skill he knew. 7 extra languages when we can barely speak English. And he spoke all of those languages fluently. He worked in between and he didn't skip a beat. I remember one day we went to the beach and he had, of course, one of his dogs. And he said something to the dog and I realized that it was not in English. I said, Daddy, please tell me you're not talking to the dog in Japanese. And he was like, why not? Who teaches their dog Japanese? Unless they live in Japan. Why of all the languages that are probably easier to learn to most, would you teach the dog to speak in Japanese? He's like, so only I could talk to the dog. And he said it to me as though it was the most obvious response that I should have come up with this on my very own without even having to ask the question. And if you know his responses, you would know that he answered you like a duh response. This is so simple. Why are you asking me these questions? But all throughout, despite his differences, and everyone knows that he lived life his own way, he operated in his own space, on his own time, that time was always punctual and correct, but he was who he was and he remained constant to who he was. He didn't change, he didn't falter, he was constant throughout. The last memory I wish to share is a guitar memory. I remember he used to come to the school at lunchtime and he would bring snacks. Of course, when I say snacks, I mean fruits, I mean nuts. I mean everything children tend not to want to eat. Those were the snacks that he brought and provided. And while my friends and I would circle a tree having our merriment, he would sit in the shade and play his guitar. He came home one evening and he was like, you should learn the guitar. I didn't remember in my Nigel moment, I looked at him and I was like, why? Why would I want to play the guitar? He's like, it's a good instrument. And just as rebellious as he was, I'm quite sure he thought he was staring himself in the face. I was like, no, thank you. I'd rather play something else. So he brought me a tennis racket. Of course, that was the natural progression. I don't want to play the guitar, I want to play something else. So he brought me a tennis racket. And I learned to play tennis and I played it quite well. And when I was ready to leave school, I was like, okay, I'm done with tennis. And he was like, why? I was like, because I want to do something different. But he always supported whatever dream I said I wanted to pursue. And he always gave his input, whether he thought I would like it or not. And again, that was who he was. So he never deterred me. Again, fierce loyalty. And I will always be thankful for that person. Thank you.
Good morning, all. I am the baby sister of Nigel. As we gather to give our condolences for our brother Nigel, I thank you. As I stand here, I share some of my memories of Nigel. It's hard to understand the loss. I remember when we moved to Phillips Road in St. Stephen's Hill. As young children, Nigel would sit on the gallery and play his guitar. And Laetitia, may God rest her soul, Shawn and I would be his audience, singing, sitting, listening to him sing his favorite songs of Earth, Wind and Fire, and Bob Marley. Nigel always had a love for education. I remember when we wouldn't do our schoolwork, we would get some lashes for that from Nigel. I wasn't surprised when he left accounting and started private tutoring. He taught many children to prepare for the common entrance exams, CXCs, and some international students with the SAT college prep. Normally, when you see Nigel on the street, he would always have a basketball, a tennis racket, a chess set, or a badminton racket, and a gammon game board. He was always into fitness. In his latter years, he started riding, and you would see him all over the country riding his bicycle. Nigel had a love for dogs. He would always be on the beach early in the mornings running with his dogs. Unfortunately, when he got sick, he had to set to get rid of them. And that, I think, broke his heart. As we say our final goodbyes, I pray your soul would be at peace from everything you were wrestling with. Rest in love, my brother Nigel.
Just to follow on from my aunt, Laetitia, to share my own memories of Uncle Nigel. I remember as a small boy, when my mom would allow me to head to St. James, for the most part, I always used to go to be with Uncle Ezra. And Uncle Ezra always used to, for some reason, the family always had this thing with the water. So Uncle Ezra used to take me out on a boat. Where was Uncle Ezra? I can't remember what he's called it. Uncle Ezra's and the catamaran. And as I got older, getting into partying and doing different things as a young man, I would be on party cruises and going down the West Coast. And there's this man with these two dogs on a kayak. And I gotta be explaining to my friends, that's my uncle. And I mean, we on the Harbor Master heading in one direction and Uncle Nigel heading in the next direction. Similar to Katrina, you know, you are always amazed by the fact that Uncle Nigel had something to teach. And he always made time to teach you something. So just like her story with the dog, you know, I remember Uncle Nigel, wait, what's that? Are you talking to your dog in? It's Japanese. So, but were you talking to your dog in Japanese? The dog is a Japanese Akita, Omar. So like she would say, it was almost that da moment, like, why are you so silly and don't understand that I need to speak to the dog in Japanese? Okay, so you're speaking to your dog in Japanese because it's a Japanese Akita. So the thing about this, you gotta understand the strategy, Omar. The only body that could tell my dog anything is me. The next memory I had with Uncle Nigel is after my mom gave me instructions to deliver something to him. He happened to be at someone's house, tutoring them and helping them to prepare for exams. No nonsense, very short fuse. You need to get it right when it's time to get it right or we can have a problem. He answered the phone. And as I was telling him that I supposed to drop off something for him, he asked me to hold on. I said, all right, what are you doing? You are wasting my time. If I am going to leave home to come down here and you plan to waste my time, let me know now. I don't have time for this. In the back of my head, listening to this conversation as he's conversing with a student, I'm like, well, these people gonna put you out the house? Because this student didn't come to him, he going to the people's house. Are you talking to the people, child? So it's like, Uncle Nigel, what happened? No, ignore me and that. That's between me and him. And, you know, it's just the discipline and the urgency, especially the urgency when it was time to get something done that Uncle Nigel had. As I started to progress through my own professional career and work, I moved from being Omar to constantly having to tell him not to call me sir. He said, after a young man reaches a certain age, there's a certain level of respect that needs to come to it. And I believe that you've earned the right for me to call you sir. So it will be simple little things where I'm talking to my uncle and refusing to let somebody in the professional environment call me sir, but I can't stop my uncle from calling me sir. One of the last voice notes that I had with Uncle Nigel while he was sick. Shawn, my mom, and I, we were looking after a few things for him. But because of the level of independence that Uncle Nigel had over the years and just his unwilling nature to depend on anybody for anything, I think that that was one of the hardest things for him to have to cope with. The fact that he became dependent on others, for lack of a better word, in terms of being dependent. And I woke up to a voice note in the morning from Uncle Nigel, you know, constantly repeating the words, sir, and being appreciative and stuff like that. And then when I looked at the other WhatsApp, because I have a work line and a personal, I realized that he had sent the message to my work line. But there's also a message on the personal line. So gone over the personal line. I'm sorry, sir. I just noticed that I sent the message to the wrong phone. I want to apologize profusely for that. From now on, I'll message you over here. Always eloquent, always prompt, always on time. And I think the one thing that I will take away is the fact that he always did it his way. You didn't have to like it. That was entirely up to you. You didn't even have to speak after. But Uncle Nigel always did it his way. Thanks again to everybody for coming.
Yes. Glad that everyone could have made it. A few words about this fantastic guy that we are here honoring. He is a no-nonsense person. He was a no-nonsense person. He is a guy that you can't get out of your mind when you meet him. And like those who spoke said, you know, whether you like it or not, he would say he was a truthful person as well. Sacrificial by no means. He would give you his last cent. All right? I remember times when I didn't have anything. Nigel came to my rescue, you know? And don't talk about giving back. You know, if you come and put it in the sign, yes, but don't talk about giving because you don't want to hear it. Nigel was, you know, so remarkable that, you know, I have so much fond memories of this guy, you know. You know, to take away anything from him, no, he knew so much. He knew so much. And you wonder, how can a person know so much, you know, languages, very educational, you know, and from the music aspect, I remember Nigel as far back as 1989, I think. Yeah, it was 1989 when I was in the Richard Stout Show. He actually gave me one of his songs to sing. And I was saying to Nigel, you know, you're giving me this song to sing, but this is your song. This is a song that you should be promoting. You know, and he gave me the song to sing, and I remembered it. It was in the finals, and it came off very well. That is one fond memory I have of Nigel. And a lot more too. But I will stop here and give some personnel some, you know, some space to say something. Thank you.
Good morning to everybody here. My name is Martin Beckles.
Nigel Beckles.
Martin. I got a call the morning. Say, can you speak to Martin, please? I said, speaking. Mr. Martin? Martin? Yes, this is Martin here. Can I help you? I said to the person, please explain yourself. Boy, here you, Dave. I said, come on, don't do that to me. My mom passed a few years ago. Don't do that to me, please. But anyhow, it's no joke. I never knew that his name was Martin either. Me and Nigel play tennis at Folkestone every evening. Val, Sammy, all the boys at Folkestone. I never knew that his name was. I never knew that he was a Beckles. So I said, life is. So it's good that we can, when we go any place, I know you. Don't want to be ashamed to ask a question. You're not being rude, you know? And I stand here this morning, Lord, I didn't even know that Nigel's name was Martin. He was giving a little girl down with me and my got some lessons. A little girl. I can't remember her name right now. And her mother, no, her mother name, though. No, they found me good, not too far from me. Nigel used to go at the house. Nigel told me on the tennis court, I'm Martin. I mean, she mother gonna come around. I said, that is not so, Nigel. Just take it easy. Man. I said, Nigel, take it easy now. Because if you leg her, here are you getting on? She's gonna pick up that. She's not gonna take in what you are trying to teach her. Next time, Martin, I hear you. But besides that, things work out. But Nigel, in my opinion, is very, very multi. He wasn't frightened for no one. Am I lying? He tell you as you see it. And nothing is wrong with that. He didn't disrespect nobody. He didn't let his education get up top him to be more than nobody. And Nigel live, I live here, Nigel just live past the gap. I even know Nigel moved to this area in Fit Village, right? But we kept close. As I stay here this morning, I must say, on behalf my family and the tennis family at four. And to Nigel's family. Nigel, may you rest.
Thank you for those tributes. You might see a golden thread running between them. Today, just before 10 o'clock, I was asked to move my car. It was about 2 minutes to 10, I was asked to move to the car park below. And because I know Nigel don't like nothing to start late, I didn't walk back wrong, I jump over the wall to make sure I get here in time. You might take a look at Katrina, Nigel's daughter, and realize he spit her out straight. She looked just like he. The only thing missing is he split between the teeth.
No, I have that. I have that.
You got it done? You got it?
No, Phil. I was born with it and they got it done.
Oh, you were born with it to coming together. Oh, so it coming together. But he split between the teeth when she was a little girl and everything. He used to tell Nigel, boy, you know, cloning is a law. You're supposed to clone yet. and the dogs though. Now he talked to the Japanese Akita in Japanese. But I mean, Hainsey, you gotta explain to me why he talked to the American pit bull in German. And the American pit bull's name was Tai Chi, which is Chinese. I mean, this man had real brain. Hear what I tell you? Real brain. And it's testimony to the kind of people who are gathered here today. It shows in the love and regard that everyone who touched or he touched their lives has for him. It comes shining through that golden thread of Nigel Beckles. And just like my boy, where you gone, Martin Beckles? Yeah, I knew Nigel was Nigel Beckles, but I went to school with a young lady called Laetitia Beckles, who never backed down, always talking up to the teachers, just like Nigel. I didn't have any idea she was Nigel's family until the other day when there was a gathering. And I said, oh, you remember when I met y'all? I said, oh, it's making sense now. Never backing down. Always unafraid to hit you with the honest truth. That's why I like Modi, because I'm the same way. I'm very blunt, and God rolled me that way. Let us have a collective reading of Psalm 34, verses 15 to 20 now. You can turn to it in your pamphlets. Say with me, the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. The righteous cry, and the Lord heareth. And save it such as the contrite spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. He keepeth all his bones. Not one of them is broken. My friends, do you have the faith? Do you have the understanding? Do you stand firm in your belief of that reading? And if you do, well, then you know that our brother Nigel is safe. Our brother Nigel is loved in heaven and on earth. I don't know why we as humans worry so much about goings on, you know, and things that happening and things. So, and this song just happens to be one of my favorites. It was one of my mother's favorites, and to render it is Nigel's beautiful daughter Katrina Thomas. Listen to these words like you've never listened to them before, to the wonderful song, His Eye Is on the Sparrow.
Why should my heart be troubled? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely? And long for heaven and home. When Jesus is my my portion. A constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. Yeah. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches. I know he watches. I know he watches you.
She can sing better than Nigel, I can tell you that. No, he could have sang, man. We used to do a lot of music together. At one point in time, I also thought he was a musician. That's how he lived, you know, man. You can tell what he could do. He could do everything. Everything. So you see the golden thread that I was talking about going through all these things, in that we shouldn't worry, we shouldn't fret. His eye is on the sparrow. The book, good book, talks about it all the time. It tells you, go to the ad, look at nature. And if you wake up in the morning, you look at the sky and what God has presented for you, well, then you will start to understand what I'm talking about here. You will start to understand the freedom that you have when you let go of all these material things and the bills and all that. And Nigel never lived like that. I never heard Nigel discuss bills yet, all the discussions we ever had. His mind and his spirit were free. And that's what nature does. Nature just goes on through. It knows that nothing can stop it. Turn with me to page 6 in your leaflets and let us look at this collective reading from Luke 12, chapter 24, 27 to 29. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse or barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, they spin not. And yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothed the grass, which is today in the field, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek not what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind. That's Nigel right there. He lived like an instrument of nature, whether on land or water. He didn't worry about where his meals were coming from. He didn't worry about the bills. All he was interested in is making sure that whoever's life he touched, they felt better because they knew him and they learned something from being around him, just like nature tries to teach us every single day. My friends, you would have heard in the test, in the tributes, that Nigel was an avid guitar player. We sat for many, many hours singing the catalog of Bob Marley and Earth, Wind, and Fire. And now to pay tribute on guitar, please welcome Tristan Haynes. Stand hands, man. Did y'all recognize this song? It was an Earth, Wind, and Fire song. September. Thank you, Tristan. Wait, Nigel teach you to play the guitar? Or you used to play guitar with Nigel? Yeah, okay. Yeah, he always was around music. And now, because you all sounded so good the first time when we sang, let's sing another congressional hymn. I'm going to invite the choir master back up to the podium to sing the goodness of God.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me.
Oh, you all know this song.
Almighty, I'm held in your hand.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay up my head, oh, I will see the goodness of God.
All my life, you have been faithful.
Can we say amen? Oh, yeah. So, from here on in, I don't want us to leave here. Say, ah, Nigel, God. I want us to celebrate that dash between October 1956 and the 2024. That dash, the part that he actually lived. Celebrate that part. When you seem to know something a little bit more about a subject that you were ignorant before you met Nigel Beckles, smile and say, oh yeah, he's still with us. I remember when my uncle Cyril died. I cried like a child. In fact, I was a child. I was only 8 years old. But I was always a little man, you know, man. So I said, I cried like a child. And my father told me something very profound that I never forgot. He said, don't cry, Kebby, because he's gone. Smile because you met him. So when it comes to Nigel Beckles, I will shed a tear. I have been while I was sitting down there. Seriously, I can't stop it. But there's always a smile on my face because of this man who I met, who I know a little more about life, a little more about kindness, a little more about giving, a little more about nature because of this guy, Nigel Beckles. Leave here remembering that dash. If you have Katrina's number, don't think this is over. Give her a call 2-3 weeks from now, 2-3 months from now, 2-3 years from now. Send her a meme or something to strengthen her spirit. Because while she was standing out here, I saw Nigel. She got the split between teeth for truth. And she got the calves. You see the calves? Yeah, she got the nice calves like Nigel. So that's the seed. From the tree, Nigel Beckles, please encourage it to keep growing. I am Kevin KB Clean-Hines. I've been a friend and brother of Nigel Beckles from 1982. And I thank you all from the bottom of my heart, on behalf of myself, the Beckles family, and especially Katrina Thomas, for coming here today. Thank you. So much. God bless you and your day.